That's the power section right there. That's it. That's fucking it. Incredible. Gentlemen, welcome back to the shop. Today, a white glove operation. You got to piss with the cock. You got, as such, I only got blue gloves. Now, as you can see, it's a treat especial. I had this gift wrapped. It's so special. And they done did gift wrap that shit for free. And you know, there ain't nothing free. Can't hardly wait. Oh boy, oh boy. Just carefully. Oh yes. It's got some gravity in her. This is going to be a good one. Oh, can't hardly wait. I will say this is a pricey tool or gadget, depending on your stock and trade. Are you ready for it? Oh, got the bottom side top wise, son of a diddly. Now this thing, the latest and greatest in technology, supposed to be super lightweight, what for not hurting your wrist before you blow your quaff. However, there's some gravitas in there. That's a heavy box. And the box, oh yeah, the box is, wow. Very sturdy, well-made box. What you'd expect for a 500 and some odd dollar Canadian peso tool. Some open cell urethane foam. This is, it's either extruded in this cross section and then die cut along this plane, or it's die cut twice. I would say it's probably only die cut the once, and it's extruded at a big long section there. As we can see, the die is that cuts this is still in real good shape. The very tip, just the tip, mind, and only for a minute, the very tip of the urethane foam isn't even close to mashed up. That's about a 3 pound foam, some sort of poking bit there. I normally let my coif drip dry on account of its military short. Oh yeah, very light. So that's interesting. That's some interesting marketing. They make the box super heavy, and then when you go to lift it out, oh my god, it's so light. This is essentially a cell phone aesthetic here. Lots of, wow, incredible amount of packaging. And this is some sort of, oh wow. They, oh, it's a BOLTR. They've actually glued that in so you can't get at the bottom side. And hips. So high impact polystyrene. Polystyrene, of course, styrofoam, and plastic cutlery is styrene. High impact. They must add 11 herbs and spices and make it just a little more resistant to impact. It is styrene. Now, what makes this so good? And I mean, if you go out and spend 500 Canadian pesos on a hair dryer and you get it home, you're going to think that it's way better. That's just science. I mean, it's 500 bucks. That's way better. I will say the marketing wank is strong with these ones. And I mean, Dyson, the guy's a billionaire. Not because he was a lonesome inventor inventing wonderful products in his mother's garage, but because he was an excellent, excellent marketer. Listen, ideas, the best idea in the world is worthless. Worthless. Unless you can commercialize it. And how do you commercialize things? Marketing. So you have to have some marketing savvy in order to get where this guy is at. Now, kudos to him, yada, yada, yada. However, let's look at the box, man. I mean, the wank is strong, right? Oh, right off the bat here, Dyson Supersonic. I don't hear any sonic. I don't foresee any sonic booms, but you never know. Air multiplier technology essentially goes through a horn of plenty. That works, actually, because they use that in the mining industry for ventilation, where they have airline that's 120 psi, and they put it into a horn and it swirls around and it pulls air. It creates a venturi and pulls air through, so you get a lot more air than is actually coming through the airline, the pressurized airline, but it drops its pressure. Also creates a lot of static. But maybe by having this grounded, no, it's a double insulated tool, so it is not grounded. So I'm curious to see how they're dealing with static. Annular element construction, that's like an accordion annular ring that heats up the air. So that's LED indicators, oh boy, blue. I'm sure there's some blue, blinding blue LED indicators on there. Everybody's favorite. Glass bead thermistor. Hey, mister, you want to buy my seester? Thermal sensor measures exit flow temperatures 20 times a second. That's incredible. That's like every 50 milliseconds. You can't do that with relay logic. I mean, that's right out of 1955. Negative ions. Oh, here we go. Charged particles in the air help reduce static in the hair. I wonder if that's the case, because as I said there, that air chooching through there creates a lot of static, and it's not an insulated tool, so yeah. So this apparently decreases, negative ions decrease static electricity. Wait a second. The charge is on the electron, so a negative would have extra electrons. That would pass the charge to the head. Wouldn't that make... Whatever. I don't have my white lab coat on, but that doesn't make a sense to me. Dyson digital motor. It's digital. Runs on ones and zeros. V9s. That's way better than the V2 rocket that the Nazis had. 13 impeller blades spin at up to 110,000 RPMs. So what's that? That's only 2,000 hertz. Maybe 1,800. 1,800 hertz. So you can definitely, will be able to hear bearing noise. Now 13 times 18, probably won't be able to hear the blades themselves. That'll be right up around 22,000 hertz. So we won't be able to hear the impeller blades, but definitely we'll be able to hear the bearings, if nothing else. It should be fairly quiet though, I would think. Acoustically tuned. Your wife can't use it as a hoo-ha rattler, but that might be a bad thing. Kind of looks like a hoo-ha rattler. Actually, that gives me an idea. If only it were twice as big. And this comes with various ancillary entitlements. A popcorn popper, and a sticker remover, and I don't know, the jet engine style. The interesting fixturing to get it on there. It's nice and solid. This is just a ceramic ferrite magnet. Probably north. Yeah, it's just unipole, so this side would be north, that side would be south, and the opposite on here. And it chooches pretty good. Got a fairly, you're not gonna, oh yeah, you might knock that off, actually. There's no injection molding markings on this. Well, no material markings on this. So we're going to have to use our brains to figure it out. It looks like it's glass fiber reinforced. And you can actually see lots of glass. Seems to be lots of glass fiber. It could be carbon fiber as well. But there's an easy way to find out is to take a little sample and then burn it. This would have to be a pretty heat resistant material on account of the heat that's flying out of there. So I wonder if it's a thermoplastic that can be remelted, or a thermoset plastic, which only burns. We're going to find out here. It appears to be melting. Yeah, it's melting. So likely nylon. That'd be a PA6 or a PA66. We're going to burn that right down. See if we can get some glass. Okay, then we'll take the bead and try and crush it. See if it crushes or breaks like glass or what happens. Oh yeah. You very likely couldn't hear that screeching, crunching, breaking, but it is glass, a little glass bead. Now it might just be the coloration, but as you can see, the texture is such that there's lots of glass fiber in there. It's got to be at least 30%, probably more like 50. You see, in this diffuser, there's stainless steel. There's a stainless steel diffuser with tiny little holes. They look to be about just a couple thou, very small. And this is cute. It even comes with a little thing that you put on your bathroom there. Feels like anti-slip pad. Feels like silicone kerny. I'd have to check, though. But, oh, there we go. This has got to be bottom side down because you got to show off the Dyson sign to the ladies' auxiliary when they come through the washroom. Oh, my Hicko 888D is out of commission for the moment, so we're going to relive our misspent youth here. Do some blade skis. What for checking to see if this is silicone kerny or just some plastic. Of course, silicone kerny, silicon, won't burn. No, it burns, but it won't melt. And there we have it. That is silicone, so that's good. Temperature resistant. Here we have the cable. It's a neoprene jacket. It is a nice cab tire. This is a direct burial cable, 90C rated. Looks to be about 18 or, if I can find it here, maybe 16 American wire gauge. Yeah, 16 American wire gauge. So they didn't cheap out on the poke and bit end. That's nice. And this is all custom, of course. Probably got a patent on that, or a D patent, a design patent, which is not really a patent. It's more just a design that they don't want anybody to copy. Jeeves, they do not want anybody getting the recipe for the secret sauce. Dyson Illuminati confirmed. This is some sort of alien technology in here. We're going to have to leave this so we can get the thing to chooch and then come back to it and yeah, necropsy it after we've done its testing, because there's no way this is coming apart in one piece. Now, this is a little too high-tech for my liking. It's got the ETL label. According to me, that's the mark of the beast, but Dyson went with these guys likely because they're a lot quicker and they're a lot less hassle, apparently, than CSA or UL. They don't get inspected. It's just quicker. However, if you look at chintzy tools from the Hazard Fraud, or here in Canada, the Princess Auto Power Fister, they all have that Intertech. I might need to revisit that. Right, wrong was I once in the 80s. Well, I thought I was wrong. Turns out I was mistaken, but one never knows. Here we got the Coates Phi meter, which is the power factor meter. This will give us watts and VA. That's apparent power. And then Coase is the Coase Phi, not Coase Theta. Coase Phi is the power factor, which is essentially how far the voltage or the current lags the voltage in any system, because this is AC, yada, yada, yada. If it's over your head, don't fucking worry about it. It's magic. Contact. Contact. Oh, sorry. Gotta arm the thing first. Contact. Holy fucking shit. There's no fucking way. 1500 watts, 13 amps, 1500 watts, that's just fucking nuts, man. This thing feels like a, no fucking way, man. Oh, drops right, look at that. Oh, it's the heating elements that are taking up all the power. Yeah, I got it down just on the blower. The blower alone is 110 watts, and then the heating elements. Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. We're on chooch factor 3 with the blow air. We can turn that down, I think. Yeah. Wow. This thing feels like the future. Aluminium, cold, and chintzy. But she hits like a fucking bloody mule. Look at that. That's hot, man. Wow. Just for confirmation, 13 amps. Yeah. Okay. So, just for funsies, I turned off the heat. We're at 100 watts. Now, this hasn't been calibrated in ever. So, you know, grain of salt, et cetera, et cetera. Hey, you too can do these kind of chintzy tests. That drops it down to 55 on the second chooch level. And then 42. Now she blows okay, but the heat, holy old fuck, the heat. Interestingly, even when it's off, it's still drawing 8 watts. So this is kind of a power suck. For some reason, my tinnitus, I had a cold recently and my ear started ringing, and it's ringing now. Whilst I got my white lab coat on, and mind you, it is greasier than most, why don't we take a look at the numbers for the hertz and the, we'll do a fast Fourier transform, we'll look at the audio signal and see what this is doing with the audio. So what we've gone and done is take a sample of the sound coming out of that Dyson blowjobber, and I put it in Audacity. Now, the interesting thing is most mechanical contrivances vibrate, have a frequency right in the auditory range of human beings. That just happens to coincide with how they build computers so that they make sounds that are appealing to us. And if you didn't know, there is a lot of computational power in computers nowadays. So we can leverage that if we have the proper software. And here we go, Audacity, one of my favorite open source free software thingamabobbers. The friggin' thing is awesome, what for looking at vibration. So we take this little sound clip here and we go analyze plot spectrum. That plots, that does a fast Fourier transform. And it essentially tells us how this thing is vibrating. Crazy, right? But what's interesting is that this is very well tuned. Even in the range where we would expect to see a big loud bearing noise, there is none, right from say 100 to 500. There's a slight peak there, but it's very well tuned to make it sound like white noise, just straight up white noise. You can see there's very little peaks, and the baseline here, minus 27 decibels, right across when it drops off to where the microphone doesn't pick up at 20,000 hertz. And way over here at say 25,000 hertz is where those 13 blades of the impeller we're be chooching at, and we can't hear that at all. Now, it's interesting to me though that this white noise, while I was doing it, bothered my ears more than the just super loud blowy. But it is, as you can see from the 27 here decibels, it is quite quiet and very well tuned. Somebody spent a lot of time getting this to sound just right. And further, we can extrapolate that there are no rolling elements in this. The bearings must be oil-like bronze bushings, ones that don't have ball bearings, because there is no resonance in the bearing range. Now, call me old-fashioned, but to my mind, a hairdryer should, whose primary function is to dry hair. As such, we're going to see how much water it can evaporate out of this sponge. You'll recognize this as the last of the tap water, it being the end of summer. All the bricks of it are gone from the wholesalers. Now we're cooking with bunker C. 6 inches, that's metric 6 inches. Now we'll weigh this thing. 8.46 grams. Those of you who find it incongruous to use inches and grams have clearly never purchased illicit drugs in North America. Corn tax. And just for your edification and viewing pleasure, in case you're a stickler for the science, we're running at 1500 watts. That's just as much as you'll suffer. Okay, I think it did a respectable 2.4 grams of water evaporated in 1 minute. Now here's the one I managed to smuggle out of the wife's paint booth. I have no idea if she does any painting in there, but it sure smells like it after she's done. This is a Testarossa by Conair. It's 1875 watts rated. Yeah, I have no idea, but let's give her a try. Well, And please, don't tell on me. Now, we're just going to see by depressing the cool air button how much power the fan is drawing, the blower. So we're at 66 at the first notch, six, and we're at 108 on the second notch. That's roughly right around where the Dyson compares. However, it doesn't have the fancy dancy arrangement. And then we'll drop this off. There's about 350 watts of heating going on there in the first notch. That's 725 watts of heating on the second notch. And then full blow. So same amount of heating roughly as the Dyson. So the question in my mind is, if this is drawing the same amount of power out of the power grid, the magic pixies in the wall that are making this dance, will it or will it not dry the sponge faster? If you listen to the marketing wank from Dyson, it should do it slower, but the proof in the pudding is in the eating. Jesus. Come on. Cordex. We're off a little bit there. There we go. Okay, so point four of a gram, say half a gram difference over 1 minute. So the Dyson actually is, it does dry better. So the question in everybody's mind should be, why would it dry better if it's got the same amount of power? Well, it must be blowing more air. Now, I don't have an anemometer or any kind of setup like that. So let's just try and fill these bin liners. We'll see how long it takes for each one to fill the bin liner, and then we'll see if it's actually choo-choo more air, which one's better. Okay, that was about 12 seconds. There's some fair pressure in there too. All right. That's it. This one was about 13, 14 seconds. This was 12, 13. Same, only different. I myself, I don't see $400 in the difference. Then again, I don't give myself a blowjob every day. But even with the water evaporating, it's getting hot on that. Now the mat is 51 degrees C. That's hot, man. So that's hot enough to burn your scalp for sure. You can see the dry part there, 43. Let's have a look at it. Well, it's pretty warm. And the motor section, cool as a cucumber. Of course, it's drawing air up through, so it would be cool as a cucumber. I'm taking my gloves off, and this thing totally scratched. And this thing totally had me fooled. I thought this was all anodized aluminum. Incredible, they did a nice job on masking the fact that it's plastic. But it's all plastic, baby. This really is a very refined design, however, for the amount of material. It's quite stiff. And like I say, I didn't... With the gloves on, they had me fooled. I thought it was anodized aluminum. I sort of been beating myself up at the back of this, trying not to hit it with a hammer, you know, and kind of dawned on me that this was the Apple school of design. So they, sure enough, did a nasty trick here. Glued on the boutons after they had slid the foreskin up and over. So you gotta peel the buttons off, essentially ruining them in order to get the... Yeah, because there's a butylene, over-molded butylene compound here over the tactile switch. that gets glued on, and yeah, there's no way around it but to ruin it. Okay, so this is where the, what the fuck, it's right, it's like Mad Max, only it's tiny, it's so cute. That must be, there's cool, that can't, no, that's not the fan, can't be. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. That's the... No fucking way. Okay, correct me if I'm wrong, but according to the marketing wank, look at this. This is a perfectly CNC'd on the compressor wheel out of a turbo. That would be the turbine. No, the impeller. Puts impetus into the air, the impeller, you know, all CNC and optimized for flow rates and yada yada yada, you know, perfectly all finite element analysis sized, high tech, right? $500 worth. A fucking pressed cut, yeah, and look at this. You think, okay, well, that just looks like a hobby, you know, a little 50-cent hobby motor. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this. Inside of there, it's not even all motor in there. Windings are nothing. Everything's, oh, $500 down the tubes. Son of a diddly. Focus, you fuck. Check this out. That's the power section right there. That's it. That's fucking it. Incredible. Upon further review, this is interesting because it looks like a die cast, not aluminium. It's got too gray of a sheen, and you can see the grain boundaries here at the surface. Die cast zinc. Zinc, no less, which is very odd, but it is. If you can look at the inner veins here, and they're cambered off to one side to try and get a bit of a swirly, I guess, to her, or to counteract the swirl of this. Maybe try and get some laminar flow in there for the annular ring. I'm not much on aerodynamics, so somebody please correct me if I'm wrong. I can't get over this. Just, that's the motor right there. And then this little Buna and beauty. Ooh, flashbacks of Panamanian Customs ribbed for his pleasure. This just goes on there, what, for minimizing vibrations into your hand so that it feels nice and smooth while you got it in your hand. So the way they make these cheapo impellers is they punch out a coin-sized chunk out of some sheet metal and then draw it. Oh, wait a second. There's some interesting artifacts here. Oh, holy. No. Mark this day in your calendar. I am dead wrong. This was CNC machined. Crazy. Crazy. You can see here. See these little artifacts here at the root of the blade? Those have been CNC machined. Wow, crazy. Okay, well that's a ridiculously insane part there. Yeah, you can see it came in with a little tiny ball mill here to fix up the root, and then the leading edge also plays like a musical instrument. That cogging is due to the fact it's a brushless DC motor. That means that we just control the field windings, and on the rotor itself, it's permanent magnets, probably neodymium magnets, N52 neodymium magnets. We just control these field windings, turn them off and on, and that's what actually makes the motor chooch. Here's another interesting artifact. You can see the cross-section here varies up until we hit this lip, and that's a pronounced lip. That's not blended very well. Yeah, I got a drop of vinegar on there, no reaction at all, so that is aluminium. However, after the machining, there was another process, well, a couple other processes, because these are all polished, nicely polished, so that would be in a vibratory polisher. And then they've actually gone ahead and laser etched a little skew on there. What for tracking, apparently, you know, parts and this and that. Make sure it goes into the right rotor. I looked up this number. Of course, it's nothing. So I don't know. I would be surprised if Dyson made, they probably offshore this, but then again, I can't say for sure. And the pole arrangement is interesting. As you can see, there's only two inputs. So what must be happening is they energize one way, and this pole would say be north, and then this guy would be north, south, south, and then they'd swap them. You'd think they'd use, you know, there's lots of room there for more poles, but that would increase the complexity. Now we're really into the meat of her. This thing was in there, but good. And we're starting to see some markings here. Polycarbonate overmolded with the butylene nitrile. And also some hard plastic in there. The real interesting thing, these probably were just glued on after the fact. But this has been metallized and made to look anodized. So a lot of processing involved to make a plastic part look like aluminium. Of course, this would be molded polycarbonate, and then they'd put this in some sort of, not a furnace, but like an autoclave, and draw everything out of it, and then they would sputter a sample. They'd blast electrons, or they'd blast a plasma at a sample, and that would vaporize it, and then it would, that metal vapor would condense on these parts on the faces that are showing. And then they'd have to anodize it as well to get that kind of finish. So a lot of processing involved in order to get polycarbonate to look just like aluminium. But like I say, they done fooled this country bumpkin. I'd like to say in my own defense, I stand on my record. I'm pretty good at not completely destroying things and getting them back together to actually test, but I had a feeling that this was going to be a little bit tough, and yeah, this is just thunderfucked. There's pretty much no way to take her apart, at least the first time. Now that I see there is a retention clip here for this, but you got to get in there with a special tool. I didn't even see it. I popped the plastic out, so you might be able to service it, but one of the problems is this ring is glued in, this heating ring is epoxied in or something. It will not come out. And the real problem is they're not stake-ons or spade connectors. They're riveted. So you got to cut the wire to get that back part out. Here's what happens though. The air chooches along in here, comes around the periphery, goes past these nichrome wires. These are the heating elements. And look at this, there's a mica insulator. Very thin, maybe millimeter thick mica insulator, and that's all that's between you and the heating elements, because this plastic, if that mica is not there, this plastic would invariably melt. Now, as an aside, I had a comment in the Metabo video about marine grade cabling and how the conductors were tinned. Well, people took that to mean a big gob of solder on the end and stick that in the lug, you know, the screw-in terminal. That's not what I meant at all. There is tinned strand conductors. Those are tinned. And that prevents, you guessed it, corrosion. The Black Death, the Green Death. That is a tinned conductor. There's the main switch. It's a Dufon, which is a French name. However, it's a Chinese company. They make switches and all sorts of switches, and you see these in Metabo grinders and power fisters and all sorts of stuff like that. They're pretty ubiquitous. We'll have a look at the brushless DC driver. They're fed by these anemic little American wire gauge 18s, but the conductor is a 200C rated, 200 dungarees centigrade rated. So it goes in here, and we can see we got a couple of MOSFETs, and these are the switches to turn on and consequently turn off the heating elements. Big beefy MOSFETs. We'll look up the number there shortly. Mylar film, I believe, capacitor, or some sort of plastic film capacitor. And then we have an electrolytic surface mount device here. We have a little fuse. And if anything goes wrong with this, good luck even getting it out without ruining the thing. 3.5 amp fuse. So that's got to be driving the motor, because of course the MOSFETs, these are big beefy MOSFETs. No heat sinking though, and we'll have a look at those here momentarily. Looks to be a voltage regulator, and then we have three wire wound big wire wound resistors, all paralleled up. So they're 15R, so that'd be around 7 ohms, 5 ohms, something like that. And that must be for current sensing, but I think those are just essentially heaters, because here we have a RT2 on the PCB. It's silk screened in there. So that RT is a resistor thermistor. So if it gets too hot on the board, a resistive thermistor, sorry. If it gets too hot on the board, that would tell the brain box to de-chooch. Here we got the rectifying bridge, 4 diodes. So that takes the AC waveform, takes alternating current, and turns it into DC. Or 120 RMS is 70 at the peak, 170. So that'll give you 170 volts DC roughly. And then this feeds into these big DC bus capacitors. Nikon, Chemicon, nice brand name. They're only 105C, could be better at 125, but that all depends on how long they want them to last, and they calculate all that out. 400 volt capacitors, 33 microfarad. So these would be all paralleled up. I wanted to show you before I took this off. Nice light pipes. So here are the LEDs, the surface mount LEDs, and you notice that the blue, you know, normally blue, when you look at a blue LED, it's just retina burning, piercing. Well, they've done a good turn and they've made those blue LEDs just nicely perceptible, so they're not overwhelming your eye. That's a nice touch. But here's the back, and the motor runs in here. No, the motor. So there really is no, for the motor, there, this is sensorless. There's no feedback into the brain box telling the brain box how fast the motor is turning. So that's, for a brushless DC motor, that's not very common, but maybe because it's turning so fast, or it doesn't really matter because it's a fan. And here we have the two little switches on the back here for fan and heat. Of course, the heat is going to be right by these MOSFETs that turn on different parts of the coil through these two wires here, hot or friggin' hot. Then on the DC bus, we've got a couple of international rectifier ICs that are ball grid array, BGA'd, and then there's all sorts of bias through the board, I assume for heat sinking or for cooling. So you can see somebody or a team worked really hard to get this to fit inside a very small enclosure. Pretty cool how they did that. We have some Celastic here, and that's just helping to keep this surface mount inductor from breaking off. This is a ferrite core, of course, with a whole bunch of copper. Fairly heavy part. This would be for a switch mode power supply. That must be turning the brain box on, feeding it power. This would probably be 3.3 volt, something or other. I assume, because this is European, Dyson, I believe it's European anyway, I assume this would be probably an Atmel device. And I'm surprised that the International Rectifier actually would think it would be an Infineon type driver, but they've gone with International Rectifier despite being almost on the continent. And here we have an interesting device, something I've never come across, and it's kind of wonky, looks like an antenna. This is a negative ion generator. So I thought about it. If you have air blasting through this thing, the air is going to give up electrons to the casement. So there'll be a static charge building up on the casement. So the air will actually be positively charged. And then what they do is they put a negative ion cannon here just to offset that. Now, I don't know what the charge is or anything like that, but they have put in a device that does put in negative ions. So, I mean, who knew? And we'll have a look at that. That's a YFA-114M UG. Just in the broad strokes, I'm going to go through what's actually happening, and at the same time, we'll discuss the components on here. So essentially, we got power coming in from the wall. AC gets switched to DC through the rectifier bridge, goes on the DC bus that takes all the ripple out of it. So this is essentially if you think about this, this is a big battery, 170 volt battery. Now what we do with that power is we take a switch mode power supply and we drop it down to 3.3 volts. That runs the computer. Now the computer is turning on and off lights, indicator lights, and it's monitoring buttons. So when you power it on, it will start that little DC motor and it's not monitoring how fast that's going. How it's doing that is it sends a signal over to here to these half wave. These are international rectifier. Well, they're 20 amp, 250 volt half bridge. They are international rectifier, which I didn't know, just got bought by Infineon. So I was right, sort of, in a roundabout sort of way. And these are half bridge, and there's two of them. So that's what's changing the field winding on the motor. And that would have to change very, very rapidly. Now, this little device here, look at the size of her, tiny. 20 amp, 250 volt rated. And it's got no cooling to speak of, like very little. It's also inside a heated enclosure. I don't see how that's going to last, but hey, they obviously, the guys at Dyson know what's going on. And from what I can see, I see a little M, microchip devices on that surface mount computer there. That's a microcontroller. Microchip bought Atmel. So that is a, could possibly be an Atmel device. I don't know how they've done the branding. I don't know if they change it all over to microchip yet, but that is either a PIC or an AT Mega of some sort. Those guys do not want us in there. I got just the thing for that. Didn't see that one coming. Fuck, for a little shitty tool, that's got some kicks. Son of a diddly. Still got them though. Still got them. 4.7 microfarads, 250 VAC, X2 caps. These would just be to suppress the noise from all that switching, from getting back, feeding back into your grid. Okay, now I really enjoyed that. I mean, I would have bet money on this being anodized aluminum. Fool me once, eh? And then this, hey, I gotta take up smoking, like that's fucking, I don't know, whatever. Here's the thing. You spent $500 on a tool of your choice, you know damn well it's got to be better than everything else. That's just science. Because if you spent $500, and it's the same thing with the audio fools, you know, you spend $10,000 on a turntable. Well, partner, you get that home, it sounds better. Because if it didn't sound better, you'd be an idiot for spending the money. Thanks for watching. Keep your dick in a vice. Holy old fuck, that's some big brass balls on somebody. $500. Jeezless. Although, what the fuck, eh? It's only a third the price of gold.